Hello everybody. Today we are going to discuss email etiquette. It is the age of email where everything has to be delivered at the speed of light. Let us see what email is all about. Electronic mail or email is the medium of communication that sends and receives messages through computer network. With the revolution in information technology and the rapid growth of internet, the email has become the most popular and powerful medium of communication. There is no doubt that due to its high speed and low cost, it is the most important means of communication. Email is less intrusive than a phone call and less hassle than a fax. It is, in fact, better than both of these. Using email, differences in location and time zones are less of an obstacle to communication. But what makes email different from other modes of communication? Electronic communication, because of its speed and broadcasting ability, is fundamentally different from paper-based communication. Because the turnaround time is fast, email is more conversational than paper-based media. In a paper document, it is absolutely essential to make everything completely clear and unambiguous, because the reader may not get an opportunity to ask for clarifications. In email document, however, the recipient can immediately ask questions. Email thus tends, like conversational speech, to be sloppier than paper-based communication. But when using email, one needs to be absolutely sure that when one can be sloppy and when one needs to be very, very meticulous. Email does not convey emotions as nearly well as face-to-face communication or telephonic conversation. It lacks in vocal inflections, gestures, and of course a shared environment. Our correspondent may find it difficult to understand whether we are serious or joking, whether we are happy or sad in our email. Sarcasm is particularly dangerous to use in emails. Our email compositions thus need to be different from our paper compositions and our speech. These days, we are all very busy. I'm sure you know that more than me because you are the youth. We are so busy that we have time for almost nothing. So much so that we don't have time to write complete words and sentences also. Letters, postcards, respected sir, ma'am, regards, or thank you. They have become a things of the past. They are empty. Our emails also are more like a shorthand writing. They are cryptic. One needs to have time to decipher what the sender means in his emails. But one thing keeps on coming in my mind. If a top CEO can find time to go for a run in the morning, why can't we have the time to write, "Dear sir, ma'am, regards," or a simple thank you? It hardly takes more than a few seconds to write these, but the receiver feels absolutely great reading them. I think it's not just a matter of not having time. It is also that we do not have the inclination to write these or use these. Etiquette or the rules governing socially acceptable behavior have not just taken a backseat, they have been actually thrown out of the window. Today, if we are polite, the world thinks there is something wrong with us. We are weird. Or maybe we lack in talent and potential, and to camouflage it, we are being courteous. What is the need of email etiquette? These days, most of our business communication is by email. In today's world of internet, written communication makes the competitive difference in an organization's overall success. Even though technology changes rapidly, has been changing and will continue to change, the rules of social and business interactions have remained the same throughout the years. The payoff of observing email etiquette are several, including increased productivity and profit. By using proper email language, we communicate a more professional image of our company. It also shows respect respect for our fellow email users. Clear writing represents clear thinking. Emails that get to the point are much more efficient and effective than poorly worded emails. Emails can be used as evidence. And so, proper email language can protect us from costly lawsuits. Why is email important? There are two points that come to your mind. Let us see each one of them in detail. Email has become very prevalent and many use it to quickly and cheaply communicate with their family, friends and co-workers. Although this technology is available to all and many are accustomed to it, yet people are still not very savvy when it comes to understanding how email functions in relationship, both personal and professional. Our email is our portrait. We are judged by the quality of our writing. We all interact with the printed word as though it has a personality, and that personality has positive and negative impressions upon us. While most people are aware that computer is not a person and that emails do not have a character of their own, yet many still react to them as though they do. People assign meaning to everything they read, and they tend to perceive it as concrete because it is in black and white or whatever color we may choose to write it in. This response, coupled with lack of non-verbal cues, poses a serious challenge for email writers. The chances of our email being misunderstood are very, very high. So it is crucial that we follow the basic rules of etiquette to construct an appropriate tone. We all have faced situations where we received an email and felt a little put off by the content, even though it was sent by a friend of ours. We all have sent an email that has upset or confused the reader. It happens. And it is because of these very awkward and uncomfortable situations that some ground rules on email etiquette were established and why email writers should be mindful of them. A professional email, the experts of communication say, should be polite, forward-looking, considerate and responsible. There are many etiquette guides and many etiquette rules. Some rules will differ according to the nature of business and the corporate culture. But the golden rule of netiquette is to remember the human. When communicating via computer, at times it is all too easy to forget that there are real people out there with real feelings and egos. If we wouldn't say something to somebody's face, we shouldn't be saying it over internet or through email. It is absolutely okay to express one's opinion, but one needs to be careful and sensitive to the feelings of others. Not only must our writing be clear, correct, complete and concise, but it must also connect to the readers. Let us see some of the important email etiquette rules that can be applied to nearly all organizations and all situations. When we look at an email, we find that there is to, CC, ECC, subject field. These are the message header components of an email. How to populate these fields? When we look at them, it seems also easy that, okay, there are just three recipient fields. Let's do it quickly and be done with it. But these three can pose a serious challenge if we are not aware of which address to put in which field. The address in the to field is of the primary recipient of the email. When we write an email, there is somebody who has to take action on that particular email. That somebody's address will figure in the to field. They are the ones who are the main receivers of our email. CC or carbon copy, as it is known, is for the people we are indirectly messaging or addressing. We are marking a carbon copy to some people Because we want them to be in the loop of communication. We want them to know what is happening. They are not the ones who will be taking any action on the email. It is only for their information that we are sending the email. FYIs, for your information only. Now most of us, what we do when we are writing our email, we mark a copy to all our contacts. That is not to be done. We need to copy email to only those people who need to be copied, for whom the matter is relevant. Maybe our immediate boss, because he needs to know what is happening. But not everybody who is not concerned with the email. BCC, or the blind carbon copy, is hidden from the to and CC addresses. They don't know that it is there. The experts of communication say that it is unethical and it should not be followed, marking a blind carbon copy to people. But there are situations, there are times when we have to do that, when we have to take recourse to this particular option in the address field. We may do it, depending on the situation and the circumstance. The next is reply to all option. At times, instead of just replying to the person who has sent us an email, we click reply all option. And our whole universe of contacts get to know what only one person was intended to know. At times, we do it intentionally. We want the world to know. Let us ensure that we use this option only when it is required. Only those messages that are meant for all eyes to see should be marked reply to all. Otherwise, reply is the standard option that we need to go for. It is also essential to understand that at times a person may receive hundreds of messages in a day. And going through all those messages, taking action and responding to them is definitely a Herculean task. To add to this Herculean task, if we get an email from somebody who thinks he is the next brainchild, is difficult. Very disappointing, very frustrating. Let us ensure that the message that we write is crisp, concise, to the point. We may have the urge to pour all our feelings, all our thoughts about that particular issue, but the other person is clearly not interested. He may not have the time nor the inclination. Why bother? Once we have written our draft, our email, let us chop it off. Let us cut away all the repetitiveness, all the emotions, all the unnecessary things that we have added, and make our message as crisp as possible. It is important to respect the other person's time. Punctuation? Yes, there are a lot of people who will say, don't get bogged down by grammar and punctuation. Just write your message and be done with. In business world, of course, it is the content that is going to matter and not your grammar. I slightly tend to differ here and quite agree with the experts of communication. Grammar makes all the difference. Punctuation makes all the difference to your content. We need to be careful of how we are writing our content. The content is important, but then how we say it is also equally important. At times we find people use a lot of exclamation signs at the end of their sentence or question marks at the end of their sentence to emphasize the content. That should not be done. A lot of exclamation marks, they are known as bands in computer circles, and they are usually used to emphasize a particular point. Let us try and avoid those bands. Let us try and avoid question marks. Three dots at the end of a sentence convey that much is left to be said. But more than three dots is no. We should not be using that. If something is important, it should reflect in our text and not in our punctuation. We are all busy people. I just told you a little while ago, and we don't have time to write complete words and sentences. And the SMS has all the more impinged on English language. The shorter the word, the better it is. The savvier we are with internet or with the modern technology, That is what we feel. But do we stop for a second and realize whether the other person has understood what we have written or not? We may use a lot of abbreviations because it is popular, because it is in to use these abbreviations. But the other person may not understand them. What is the point of using them? We have traded clarity for confusion because of these abbreviations, because of this SMS language. Let us try and use only those abbreviations which are common knowledge for everybody. For example, I used an abbreviation in the previous slide, FYI, for your information only. Or there is ASAP, as soon as possible. These are the common abbreviations and they can be used. It is okay to use such things. But I would say avoid abbreviations. After all, how long does it take to write a complete word? Writing F-O-R or 4, how long does it take? It's almost the same time. So why not write the complete word and have a better message? It appeals to our senses. It is easy to understand. It looks good. There are so many advantages of writing the complete thing. But if we must use abbreviations, let us try and use abbreviations that are much acceptable, that are known to everybody. Salutation. Now here's a tricky thing. What kind of salutation should be there? How do we open our email? Do we write dear sir? Do we write respected sir? Do we write dear Mr. Sharma Varma? Or do we write dear Ram or Shyam? Or just Ram? How do we open our email? How do we address the recipient of our email? Well, if you asked Ms. Vanas, she would have said, use the standard format. You will never go wrong. You will not hurt the sentiments of anybody by using the standard format of politeness. If not, there are some basic things. For example, dear sir or ma'am. This communicates that you do not know the other person at all. And so, at times, it is also used because you are not sure whether the recipient is ma'am or sir. And to avoid any kind of uncomfortable or awkward situation, we use both the terms. Respected is a little outdated these days, but if you want to use, no one's going to stop you. No one's going to be hurt if you use respected instead of dear. Dear Mr. Sharma or dear Dr. Anand or some such thing, wherein you have dear, you have Mr. or Doctor or Professor and followed by the title. This is used when you know the addressee formally, but you are not very well acquainted with him or her. You are not intimate with him or her. And so you write, dear Dr. Sharma, dear Mr. Sharma. If you address the person in person by his or her first name, feel free to do so in your email also. If in face-to-face conversation, you could add Mr. or you could add Sir, use it that way. Ram, just writing the first name shows that you are very, very familiar with the other person and so you can take the liberty of addressing him or her by the first name. They say that there is no need to write salutation for a new mail to the same person. Supposedly in a day you write 10 emails to a particular person, there is no need to write salutation for every email. That is what the today's generation says. I would say you need to write salutation for each new subject mail. Every time you write an email on a different subject, use salutations. But if it is on a one particular subject thread that you are continuously writing and you skip on the salutation, it is okay. If you write, it is very good, better it is. But if you don't, it is still okay. But when it comes to a new subject line, salutation should be there no matter what. In a paper document, this is how we end our document. We have our signature, we have our name, full name, we have our designation, department, and we have name of the company. This is how our email needs to end also. But one thing needs to be taken care of. If it is an outbound email, if your email is moving out of your organization, then these things become more important. If it is an in-house email, where everybody knows everybody, There is no need to write your designation, your department and name of the company, because it is the same company. Just your name is enough to communicate who you are. People know you already. But if your email is outbound, please ensure that you have all of these things, because then they may not know who you are. They may be caught unprepared. Attachments. We all have faced a situation where we had an attachment in our file and our system gets handled. We don't know what to do. We need to respect the time and bandwidth of the receiver. Whatever we do, we should understand that they may not have the same format that we are using. We may have a large bandwidth, we may have high speed connectivity, but they may not have, or their system may not accommodate this kind of large file. So it is said that 5 MB is the size which is generally acceptable for sending out an attachment. At times, people do not understand, or they are unable to figure out why they are not able to download the file or what program it is saved in. So ideally, what we should do, that we should have the correct name for our attachment, we should take care of the size and the program it is saved in, we should put it in the email, in the cover letter. That makes it easier for the other person to understand how to go about it. We also need to ensure that our attachment is virus-free. The other person will definitely not appreciate if his system gets infected by a virus that we have sent through our attachment. What is flames, and what does it mean by being to be flamed? Well, flaming is a term for venting or sending inflammatory messages through an email. Inflammatory could be insensitive, it could be insulting, it could be negative, or it could be outrightly scathing remarks in an email. One needs to avoid flaming because it tends to create a great deal of conflict that spirals out of control. The term flaming is derived from the use of the word incendiary to describe particularly heated email discussions. Flaming is assumed to be more common today because of the ease and impersonality of email communication. Confrontations in person or via telephone require direct interaction. And social norms encourage civility. Civility does not permit direct interactions. But typing a message to someone through an email is an indirect interaction, and here civility may be forgotten. That is why flaming has become a very, very common thing today. Sometimes the reason for flame is very obvious, and at times we just don't know what happens. We have sent the same email to 10 people, 9 people respond in a positive manner, but one sends a flame. One gets hurt. That is where the email etiquette comes into it. If we are careful, if we are sensitive to the feelings of others, if we understand that everybody sees the world in a different manner, things become a little more easier. It is essential that we understand how unproductive flaming emails are and the snowball effect they can have in the office. Because emails can be forwarded, they can be printed, and lot many people come together in this flaming thing. If we do get an email and we decide that we have to, absolutely have to respond to an inflammatory email message, then we need to understand we will end up in a flame war. Flame war is where two people or more people end up exchanging flames for an extended period of time. When we get a message and we are tempted to send a flame, we need to calm down. We need to just keep that email with us, that thought with us for a minute, and ask ourselves, would we say that thing to the other person face to face? If not, let us not send it. Let us calm down. Yes, our sensitivity, our feelings have been offended. Think about it for a second. Don't just hit the button send. Because once sent, we are sure to get caught up in a flame war. twice and possible thrice. If possible, sleep over it for a few hours and then see whether we still want to send that message. Chances are, we would have calmed down, cooled down, and we wouldn't want to send the message because we understand by that time that it is silly. We are overreacting. Let us not do it. But if we are caught up in this kind of situation and we are responding to flame, we must do everything in our capacity to remain professional and neutral. Emotions will come big time. Because emails, I told you earlier, are indirect communication. So it is easy to type them out. But we will have to take stock of our feelings and keep calm. Emails are notorious for creating misunderstandings. We need to be as clear as possible, as empathetic as possible when we are responding to a flame. We need to empathize with the sender's frustration. If we have received a flame, we need to empathize. We need to try and step into the shoes of the other person and see what he is going through. If we stop and do this kind of thing, we are not going to further send any other flame message. If we feel that the other person who has sent the flame is right, no point in bringing your ego in. Just thank them for bringing the matter to your attention. That will diffuse the whole situation, and in future the other person will think definitely twice before sending out a flame to you. Explain what led to the problem in question, if possible. Although at this point of time, if you've already received a flame from someone because of your action, explaining to the other person will not help. Still, try your best. Maybe if possible, write down the message, see whether it is clear, whether it is achieving the same effect that you desire to achieve, and then try and send it across, explaining what is the real thing. Avoid getting bogged down by details and minor arguments. At times, those minor things can be overlooked, can be ignored. Overlooking and ignorance is definitely a bliss when we are dealing with flame. If we are aware that the situation is in the process of being resolved, let the other party know of the updation. Let them know at the very beginning of your response that yes, you are already about to resolve the issue. You understand the other person's concern and you are going to resolve it. If required, apologize. We never lose anything by apologizing. But it definitely eases the situation. It definitely soothes the hurt feelings of the other person. If none of the above tactics work and the flaming still continues, the war is still on full-fledgedly, then it is appropriate to take this matter outside the electronic sphere into the traditional interpersonal sphere. Talk face-to-face to the other person. I told you earlier, email is notorious for creating misunderstandings. One, because it is just a printed word. There are no non-verbal cues attached to it. It cannot communicate your feelings, your emotions, as well as a face-to-face communication. The reader, in his own state of mind, may assign any kind of meaning to the content that we have sent. But if it is face-to-face, he can see our facial expressions, he can see our gestures, and try and get a better picture of what we are going through. So if nothing works, it is essential that we move out into the interpersonal sphere and try and sort it out there.